Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we're going to be discussing the reality of the Los Angeles Lakers. But before we hop into all that, I want to give a quick shout out to our subscriber today, as always. And today is going to be Alex Hemingway. Thank you so much for like, commenting, and subscribing, supporting our YouTube channel and our podcast overall. We greatly appreciate that. Now, Greg, obviously, today's topic of discussion is going to be the Los Angeles Lakers. Everybody knows that they've gotten off to a pretty slow start. I think they ranked 7th in the Western Conference currently right now, and you know, they've just been unable to, you know, achieve much on either side of the basketball. There's been 4 glaring issues specifically that I want to talk about today, and that's the defense, the fit, coaching obviously, and then mentality. But just to start off with the defensive issues, Greg, what are some things that you think that they need to clean up from that perspective in order for them to, you know, kind of stay competent on that side of the basketball?
Well, I think, I mean, when you're looking at their defense, I mean, it's surprising that they're bad because, you know, they have a defensive-minded head coach, but it's the personnel, Nicely. I mean, the guys that they brought in 14 new guys, and it's a lot of old guys. And these old guys, I mean, they can score, but when on the defensive end, it's not like they're going to bring it each possession. And that's what the Lakers need if they want to win games. I mean, these guys are known for, you know, getting stops and getting out in transition. And because of that, since they can't get stops, they're not getting out in transition and getting those easy baskets. So that's one thing that's been hurting them. So the personnel, having these old guys, and then the lack of communication. I mean, I watched the Clippers game the other night, and they doubled Paul George early in the shot clock, but left Luke Kennard open. I mean, he can knock down threes. So anybody in the league can knock down wide open threes, but especially Luke Kennard. I mean, he did it at Duke, and he did it that night against the Lakers. So just the lack of the communication, I think that's another, and them not being connected on the defensive end is one glaring issue why they've been struggling, and it's ridiculous, and I don't understand why they can't get this chemistry down yet.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it has to do with, you know, the moves that they made in the offseason, essentially destroying the previous roster and bringing in 14 new guys and only having, you know, LeBron James, Talen Horton-Tucker, and Anthony Davis, you know, the three main guys that were a part of that championship team the last time they won in 2020. And, you know, with that being said, they're going to struggle with cohesion to, you know, start out the year. They're going to look disgruntled, have some pretty bad moments on that side of the basketball as far as, you know, just communicating with each other, figuring out each other's sweet spots and, you know, things of that nature. But, you know, I think one of their glaring issues is probably the fact that they don't really have any production defensively on the perimeter. They thought bringing in Avery Bradley was going to be able to, you know, contribute to that, despite them losing Alex Caruso, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, and, you know, guys like that. But that just hasn't really been the case so far. And they're also dealing with, you know, a few guys being out due to injury. That's been a big reason. That's why, you know, the chemistry also hasn't been there. And, you know, once those guys come back, including guys like Kendrick Nunn and Trevor Ariza, hopefully they're going to be able to alleviate some of the bleeding defensively. We know Carmelo Anthony and Rajon Rondo, those are guys that we just do not want to see on the court from a defensive perspective, because Carmelo Anthony, he's getting picked on in isolation scenarios, and they're forcing it forces the Lakers to have to, you know, isolate screens and things of that nature, and they just haven't had enough ball pressure in order to stop guys from getting through and throughout the lane and things of that nature. But I think those are probably one of the biggest reasons as to why, you know, they haven't been all that great defensively. Also tying in the fact that this is the oldest team in the NBA, they're not going to have a lot of motivation to, you know, want to stop guys and, you know, keep them in front defensively. So I think that's one of the biggest reasons as to why they haven't been all that productive this year. But let's talk about the fit, Greg. I know the spacing has been one of the, you know, one of their biggest problems this entire season, especially offensively. I think it's starting to affect guys like Anthony Davis as far as like just his overall production and percentages on the offensive side of the basketball. But what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think to your point, it's definitely hurting AD. I mean, he's struggling shooting the ball right now. I think he's the worst in the league right now, which is crazy. And we need more from him. But as far as a jump shooter, but it's really because of the lineups. I mean, I mentioned to you a few nights ago that they've had 9 different starting lineups. So trying to get that chemistry not only with your starters with LeBron, AD, and Russ, but trying to get that chemistry with the role players is hard with people in and out of the lineup, injury, stuff like that. They can't really get in the groove, and like they have scores. I like what I'm seeing out of Malik Monk. They have guys who can really put the ball in the basket, but they're not communicating well on the offensive end. It's a lot of LeBron James, Anthony Davis screen, pick and roll, a lot of Russell Westbrook and Anthony Davis screen and roll. I want to see more movement. I mean, they are seventh in assists because you have guys like LeBron and Russell who can distribute the ball and find open teammates. But if you by the eye test, they're not really moving the ball. The mall doesn't get the defense to move and manipulate. So I want to see more movement on that end. And they don't have a lot of guys who, you know, cut to the basket. I mean, missing guys like Caruso and guys like that who know how to move all ball is definitely hurting them right now. And I don't think the spacing is too bad. I mean, they're shooting better from the three than they were last year. They're 14th this year in 3-point team percentage. So it's getting better, but I still want their offense to be more fluid and get easier baskets. So that's what I'm seeing out of the offense and from the Lakers this year.
I would actually disagree with their spacing not being bad, because it's not as horrible as NBA Twitter makes it seem, Greg, but
having
Russell Westbrook, you know, Taylor Horton Tucker on a perimeter at the same time, two guys that aren't really too much of a threat from outside in terms of, you know, knocking down 3-point shots, I think that starts to affect guys like Anthony Davis. And, you know, that's why we're seeing, you know, such low percentages in essentially every aspect of his game on the offensive side of the basketball. And the fact that, you know, that the rest of this team, we don't really have any legitimate shooters outside of Carmelo Anthony. I mean, Malik Monk, he can get hot every now and then, but he, for the most part, he's pretty much up and down, a little bit inconsistent. And that's a big reason as to why, you know, this offense kind of looks a little bit janky at times. You know, the inconsistent perimeter production. Sometimes, you know, I have this feeling that a lot of the pieces on the perimeter don't really complement each other all too well, like guys like Taylor Horton Tucker playing alongside Malik Monk. It's not necessarily a terrible fit, but I just don't think that those particular guys bounce off each other too well, because most of these guys, this isn't a roster that has a lot of guys that are just going to spot up and knock down shots from outside. They like to get their own baskets individually, like guys like Malik Monk, Taylor Horton Tucker, you name it. And I think that, you know, has to do with the reason why, you know, there hasn't been too much cohesion offensively. They've started to pick it up a little bit, you know, just because we got some more games under our belt and things of that nature. But and the lack of cohesion in the beginning of the season was the reason as to why, you know, outside of Russell Westbrook just not being an accurate passer, was one of the reasons as to why, you know, they were turning the ball over so much. So I mean, as far as the fit, we could argue whether or not, you know, certain pieces fit well with each other, but I think overall this isn't a roster that has like the championship acumen to be able to be competent on the offensive side of the basketball.
Yeah, you're right. And one more thing I want to add is they also need to find their identity on offense. I mean, you talked about the cohesion, but I think they're known. I mean, these guys can dominate the paint, but I think with the versatility of scorers that they have, like a LeBron or Russ, guys who can dominate the paint, and AD, having guys like Malik Monk and Taylor Horton Tucker who can create their own shot, they should be able, you know, to really be more fluid on the offense. So I think it's on Frank Vogel as well. We need to talk about that nicely, that he needs to put the right personnel on the floor that really complements LeBron, AD, and Russ as well.
Absolutely. And you know, we're going to talk about Vogel right now, because the coaching has definitely been a big part as to why, you know, the Lakers haven't been all that well this season. You know, it doesn't really seem like at times, especially in the beginning of the season, Vogel, it seemed like he wasn't putting a lot of offense on the floor. He was playing guys like Kent Bazemore in lineups that included DeAndre Jordan and Russell Westbrook and LeBron James and then Anthony Davis, or, you know, things of that nature. And once again, that kind of goes back to what I was talking about earlier with the fit. Some of these pieces, they just aren't complementary to each other, and that's going to lead you to a lack of offensive production, right? But, you know, I think, you know, he needs to do a better job of, you know, putting more offense on the floor. I know they're a little bit limited due to the fact that, you know, there's a lot of guys out of the lineup. LeBron James hasn't even played 4 games in a row this season, and he essentially is your offense. When we look back at, you know, how the Lakers performed in the 2020 NBA Finals and, you know, that entire season, it was more so the fact that, you know, Vogel just kind of rolled the balls out and allowed LeBron James and Anthony Davis to, you know, screen and roll and make most of the decisions offensively. And now he's put in a situation where he has to do, you know, a lot of offensive scheming and things of that nature, and the offense just looks stagnant. There's not a lot of, you know, cohesion from that perspective. Once again, the complementary pieces just aren't there necessarily, and I think they're just a little bit too reluctant on AD and LeBron.
Yeah, I totally agree. He needs to do a little bit more coaching on the offensive end. You're definitely right, because I think they're struggling trying to put the ball in the basket. I mean, one thing that's really at least a big thing for him is that they're getting to the free throw line, but the sad part is they're 27th in free throw percentage. So they get to the line, they're fifth in the league in that, but they can't hit their free throws, and that's something that they're struggling. They struggled with it the other night against the Clippers. So the fact that they can't get out in transition because their defense is bad, and the fact that they get to the line and can't knock down and get easy buckets is the reason why, on top of that, to their offensive production, where they can't get these easy baskets nicely.
Absolutely. And one thing I want to highlight about this offense before we switch over to the mentality, because I think that's another reason that's why, you know, they just haven't been all that competent this year.
Yeah.
I think at this stage of LeBron James' career, I know a lot of people talk about LeBron needs shooters around him, but I actually disagree with that. I think LeBron needs scorers around him, legitimate guys like a DeMar DeRozan, a Zach LaVine around him on his roster, because we're starting to see the decline athletically in LeBron James's offensive arsenal and everything. He's not getting to the basket as much. And, you know, in those times when he does, he just doesn't look the same. He doesn't seem like he has that that similar explosion and power that he's had in, you know, years past. And I think, you know, with that being said, if he's not going to be able to, you know, really put all that much pressure slashing to the through and throughout the lanes, that also is going to affect the, you know, percentage and the amount of open looks at those guys on the perimeter that are quote unquote supposed to be your shooters being able to, you know, knock down shots and things of that nature. So I think with that being said, I would have liked this team to add a little bit more individual scores. I know Malik Monk, I talked about him being, you know, an individual scorer, but once again, he's a little bit more inconsistent than anything. So that's kind of my thoughts on that.
Yeah, I agree with you.
But let's switch over to mentality, because I think this is one of the biggest things that can kind of get overlooked in terms of, you know, this Lakers team. And I'm going to start off with them just not sacrificing enough. I don't necessarily know if, you know, Anthony Davis is eager enough to, you know, win another championship. I kind of, when we see how, you know, he plays and everything in terms of, you know, him just having this dog mentality, he doesn't really seem like he has this it factor. You know, we look at guys like Giannis, Ja Morant, who, you know, are always on go looking to prove their doubters wrong every single night that they step on the floor. I don't necessarily see that from Anthony Davis. He does a lot of, you know, critiquing guys when he's going over to the post game and press conference interviews and things of that nature, but it doesn't really seem like he always holds himself accountable. And in terms of guys like Russell Westbrook, I gotta ask him, are your individual stats more important than, you know, the Lakers coming up with a W? I don't know all the time. And then in terms of guys like Malik Monk, who I brought up multiple times on today's episode, did you sign with the Lakers to compete for a championship and, you know, get mentored by LeBron James, Anthony Davis, and Russell Westbrook? Or did you sign with LA because you wanted to live that LA lifestyle off court and things of that nature? So that's just kind of my thing, you know, in terms of mentality. I kind of question it a little bit. These guys don't always look like they're on the same page. But what are your thoughts on that, Greg?
Yeah, and I see one thing I've talked about to you is definitely Anthony Davis, and that's who I'm going to talk about, mentality. I mean, he's a guy that, like you said, always vocalizes in the post game that we suck, or we do this, we're bad at this, or we're bad at that. But he's not taking the initiative. He's not the one that's like, he's supposed to be the anchor of the defense. He's supposed to be the one that buys everybody in, gets everybody to buy in on the defensive end and buy in each night. And he's trying to be that leader in the locker room vocally, but it's not really translating, because I mean, they're 500 on the season and LeBron's been in and out, so he's the next man up. He's the guy that's supposed to do the job, and it's really not translating to these other players. So I totally agree with you, man. The mentality's got to change. These guys got to lock in, because like I told you, if they don't get a top four spot, it's going to be tough in this Western Conference, especially what we're seeing out of the Suns, the Warriors, and the Nuggets, and all these other teams in the Western Conference. It's going to be tough to try to get to the NBA championship lower than the top four seed.
Absolutely. I agree 100%. And one thing about Anthony Davis, this is a guy that when LeBron James is not featured within the lineup, he should be averaging around 30 and 10, you know, he should be salivating at the mouth in terms of, you know, just looking at his offensive production. You know, that's a guy that has to be able to take over. And then I think his game more so is going to do more of the talking than, you know, him doing it verbally himself, because it doesn't seem like his words are really connecting within that locker room and everything. And I think that's a real problem. But let us know what you guys think about this situation with the Los Angeles Lakers in the comment section. Thank you guys so much for tuning into another episode with me and Greg on the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're new to our YouTube channel, or you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice little review. But besides that, it's your boy Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host Greg King, and we out.
We out.